Our topic this evening, my brothers and sisters, is Christ and His infinite atonement. And in this, we're getting to the heart of this whole cosmic picture of life. On one occasion, the prophet Yoda Smith was asked the question, "What are the fundamental principles of your religion?" If you ask that question to many modern Latter-day Saints, they'd say, "Well, eternal marriage, word of wisdom, we believe in 3 degrees of glory, true earth existence, and I don't know what other." But here's how the prophet answered it. He says, "The fundamental principles of our religion are the testimony of the apostles and prophets concerning Jesus Christ, that He died, was buried, and rose again the third day, and ascended into heaven, and all other things which pertain to our religion are only appendages to it." Now, do you think of the gospel in that sense? If we don't, you're off base. And then he added, "But in connection with these fundamental principles, in connection with these, we believe in the gift of the Holy Ghost, the power of faith, the enjoyment of the spiritual gifts according to the will of God, the restoration of the house of Israel, and the final triumph of truth." Now, I'd like to spend the evening with you on this most sacred topic, Christ and His infinite atonement. This is the very heart of things. It's the very center of life. It's the center of liberty. It's the center of existence. It's the center of the galaxy. It's the greatest act of this eternity. It was the act of Gethsemane and Calvary. And it's the heart and the core and the foundation of exalted life in the worlds to come. All existence in the future will focus and center, be based on those two great accomplishments, Gethsemane and Calvary. See, that's how important it is. And it's centered then in the doctrine of the fall. You have to know the fall in order to appreciate why the atonement, and to know even that you need it, as President Benson said. Now, the ancient prophets look forward to the atonement of Christ for their salvation. And you see that, for example, in the Proto-Day Christ very clearly. Let me suggest you turn to Moses chapter 5. Here, beginning with verse 5, the record says this, "And He gave unto them," that is, God gave unto them, Adam and Eve, "commandments, that they should worship the Lord their God, and should offer the firstling of their flocks for an offering unto the Lord. And Adam was obedient unto the commandments of the Lord. And after many days, an angel of the Lord appeared unto him," and those many days included him growing to be a grandfather. If you read the earlier verses. So he was a grandfather. "After many days, then an angel of the Lord came to Adam, saying, Why dost thou offer sacrifice unto the Lord? And Adam said unto him, I know not, save the Lord God commanded me. And then the angel spake, saying, This thing is a similitude of the sacrifice of the only begotten of the Father, which is full of grace and truth. Wherefore thou shalt do all that thou doest in the name of the Son, and thou shalt repent and call upon God in the name of the Son forevermore." Now, here then is the great revelation of this central focal act. And it shows the relationship then of this great law of sacrifice, pointing to the sacrifice of Jesus Christ and finding its fulfillment in that. And when was it given? As the first given law that was given to Adam after the law of obedience. The law of obedience, and then the law of sacrifice. And all of this, then, actually prior to his leaving the garden. Prior to that. And he left the garden then into the fallen state with those two commandments, those two covenants of obedience and sacrifice. Not knowing fully the reasons or the ramifications or the whys or the wherefores of them, but living until he was a grandfather faithfully. Now you talk about the law of integrity, there it is. And sometimes we have to, and too often this is the case, we need to know the wheres and the wherefores and the whys and the whens and the whats and all those things about a particular issue before we're ready to act on it. And this because we say we've got to preserve our independence. Well, you don't preserve our faith that way. You may preserve your independence, and it just may be that that independence has a little false color to it. Sometimes pure obedience, simply because the Lord says so, is the case. Just pure obedience. And the Lord revealed this then to Adam and indicates that it's a great similitude of the coming sacrifice of Christ, which is the focal point of his life from that point on, and of the very existence that even he then had, because the power of the atonement then began to operate at the same time the fall did. And he then began to realize the truths of life on that occasion. Now, in chapter 6, verse 57, here's another statement that relates to Adam. This particular statement is one that Enoch quotes from the Book of Remembrance and gives to the people. It actually originally was a revelation given to Adam. And Adam is told, "Wherefore, teach it unto your children that all men everywhere must repent, or they can in no wise inherit the kingdom of God, for no unclean thing can dwell there, or dwell in his presence. For in the language of Adam, man of holiness is his name, and the name of his only begotten is the Son of Man, even Jesus Christ, a righteous judge, who shall come in the meridian of time." And so Adam then knew concerning Christ, and he knew the right relationship. When you talk about Christ and use the term Son of Man, the sectarian world identifies that with his, what they call, mortality. That he is one of us. And the word Son of Man means that he is a son of mortality, who was infused with the Spirit of God and lived an innocent life and made an innocent sacrifice. That's basically the idea of the Christian world. Now, the Son of Man is an abbreviation for the more complete term, Son of Man of Holiness. And it should be capitalized. It relates to his deity. Now, it relates to his manhood because we are the species of God. We're his children. And we're here in the flesh as descendants of him. In a fallen state, true. But we're still of the species of the gods. But the term itself doesn't relate to the fallen order. The term relates rather than to the glorified order, the man of holiness. And he's holy by reason not just of perfect obedience to law, but he's holy because he possesses the attributes of perfection, the attributes of justice, of mercy, of truth, of power. And on that basis, he is holy. And the name of his only begotten Son is the Son of Man of Holiness. Now, Adam was taught this doctrine. Coming down to Enoch, for example, chapter 7 of the book of Moses, in verse 45 and through 47, it says this, beginning out of verse 45, "And it came to pass that Enoch looked, and from Noah he beheld all the families of the earth. And he cried unto the Lord, saying, When shall the day of the Lord come? When shall the blood of the righteous be shed, that all they that mourn may be sanctified and have eternal life?" Now, There's joy and happiness in contemplating the atonement. Just like there's joy and happiness in contemplating the results of a beautiful pregnancy. You're going to have a little one in the family. And you proudly bust your buttons and say that. And I think he's going to be a boy, you know. And she thinks she's going to be a girl. But we're going to have a little one. And you don't really think of the ordeal of birth. You just think of the joy of the fruits of that union. You see that? Now, Enoch then rejoiced. And he said, "When shall the blood of the righteous be shed?" And then the Lord explained to him, "It shall be in the meridian of time, in the days of wickedness and vengeance." And Enoch saw the day of the coming of the Son of Man, even in the flesh, and his soul rejoiced, saying, "The righteous is lifted up, and the Lamb is slain from the foundation of the world. And through faith I am in the bosom of the Father, and behold, Zion is with me." Now what does that term foundation of the world mean? Let's not skip by without making a comment on it. What is the foundation on which this world is built? And the answer to that is the spirit world. The spirit world is the foundation on which the physical world is built. And what does it mean that he's slain from the foundation of the world? It means that the atonement was contemplated, planned for, designed, and entered into on the basis of covenant from even the spirit world. And if you'll receive it even earlier than that, from before the foundation of the world, it was contemplated that Jesus would die. And that this would be a part of this great scenario, see. And it's a matter to rejoice in. The Lord isn't pleased with people when they go around with a long face as they talk about Calvary and Gethsemane. He's not pleased. He may be pleased and is pleased when the contemplation of those sacred events brings the broken heart and the contrite spirit. He is pleased on that. But for a person to go along with a long face, with some sanctimonious religious feeling that incites sorrow and penance instead of repentance, the Lord isn't pleased with that. Rather, instead, he expects us to know and to understand and to feel and to appreciate and to reciprocate that love. We can't understand the atonement, but we can understand that there was an act of love there. And then to reciprocate that love in our lives, in our relationship with each other, see. He does expect that. And then he expects us to rejoice. Rejoice that the Lamb has been slain. Rejoice that the righteous has been lifted up. And that the benefits of all that love of the Father and of Christ in doing that, the undergirding love, the undergirding sentiment that brought about that thing, this thing is the basic foundation on which you rejoice. It's John chapter 3 verse 16. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. You see that? And then you rejoice in the fruits of it. And then you have a great respect for the pain and the anguish. And you have a tremendous standing in awe of the integrity that was there. The great example of integrity with Christ. So you have that. And so Enoch then rejoiced in this. And he looked forward to this great central act that is the very foundation of existence. And so also you have, for example, the Lord over here in chapter 8 of the book of John, as the Jewish people are pummeling him about who he is and what he's teaching and about how great they are because they descend from the right bloodlines and all that distortion that they gave to sacred things. In verse 56, for example, Jesus said, Your father Abraham rejoiced to see me, my day, and he saw it and was glad. Now, can you get that focus where people are seeing and understanding and rejoicing thousands of years beforehand concerning the coming of Christ? That's the sentiment. Now, one point that's important, and that is that in Christ you have the sacrifice of a God, not just a God, but you have the sacrifice of the God of this earth. He wasn't just elder brother who kind of walks along and pats you on the back and say, "Hey kid, I'm with you all the way." There is a great difference between the love that you have for an elder brother and the love that a righteous person has when he falls on his knees and says, "My Lord and my God." There's a great difference between the love that you have. One is fellowship, and the other is deeply centered in the inner regions of the soul and in the powers of the Spirit that quicken your life and fill you with a respect and an integrity and a love that mere fellowship just doesn't reach. Now, in that sense, then, Christ is our God. As Enoch says, "I know thee, and I know that thou art God." See? And you have the sacrifice of a God. Enoch knew that Christ would make an infinite sacrifice. And so he then spoke of they that mourn might be sanctified and have eternal life. In the Book of Mormon, for example, Abinadi, I've referred to this before in chapter 15, gives us the classic statement of Christ. If you want any statement in Scripture that is the classic statement of Christ, it's Mosiah 15. And keep in mind that this is a commentary on Isaiah chapter 53, that great prophetic biography that Handel took so many things from in writing the Messiah. He has borne our grief, he's carried our sorrows, and with his stripes we are healed, see. It's that great prophetic biography written 700 and some odd years before the birth of Christ. And having put that in Mosiah chapter 14, it's the whole chapter, then Abinadi comments on that in this way. He says, "Now Abinadi said unto them, I would that ye should understand that God himself shall come down among the children of men and shall redeem his people." Now this is on elder brother, that God himself shall come down. In order to appreciate and understand that clearly, you have to go back to verses 10, 11, and 12 and read and understand them. That is 10, 11, and 12 of chapter 14. Now we talked here yesterday about, when was it? I've not talked so much around here, I don't remember when it was happened. We were talked about Christ as a dual being, as the Father and the Son. And his functioning and speaking and acting as the Father and the Son. Now this is the idea of Isaiah. "Unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. The government shall be upon his shoulders, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father." You see that? Who is Christ? Among other things, he's the Mighty God and the Everlasting Father. And he speaks and he acts and he is as the Father and the Son. And if you want to see that clearly, just really study the three previous verses to Mosiah 15. Let me read them with you and do some insertions. I'm going to put the word S for Father, that it's the Father speaking, and it's all Christ, but he's talking out both sides of the issue. I'm going to put the word S as the Son, and I'm going to put the letter, FS, when he's speaking as the Father and the Son. Okay? Now read it with me. "Yet it pleased the Lord," FS, the Father and the Son, "to bruise him," S, the Son, "he," the Father. F, hath put him, S, the Son, to grief. When thou, F, the Father, shalt make his, S, the Son, soul an offering for sin, he, S, the Son, shall see his, S, the Son, seed. He, S, the Son, shall prolong his, S, the Son's days. And the pleasure of the Lord, S.S., shall prosper in his, S, the hand. He, the Father, shall see the travail of his, the Son's soul, and shall be sanctified, and shall be satisfied. By his, the Son's, knowledge shall my, the Father's, righteous servant justify many. For he, the Son, shall bear their iniquities. Therefore will I, the Father, divide him, the Son, a portion with the great. And he, the Son, shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he, the Son, hath poured out his, the Son's soul unto death. And he, the Son, was numbered with the transgressors. And he, the Son, bore the sins of many and made intercession for transgressors. Now that's all one person speaking all about one person. The Father and the Son in that being we call the Messiah. You see that? And then with that understanding things from that standpoint, then Abinadi opens up with his classic commentary. And he says, now I would that you should know that God himself shall come down among the children of men and shall redeem his people. And because, now this is his explanation of those verses that we've put those inclusions or insertions in. And because he dwelleth in the flesh, he shall be called the Son of God. And having subjected the flesh to the will of the Father, having subjected himself to the will of the Father, being the Father and the Son. This one person is the Father and the Son. And then there's a dash there, which means, now let me tell a little more about that latter one. The Father, because he was conceived by the power of God. When he was conceived, he wasn't just merely given physical attributes. He had the divine nature. He was conceived with glory in him. He was conceived with power in him. And that glory and that power was the mind, spirit, and power of the Father. And the Father was in him by conception. Okay? You see that? The Father, because he was conceived by the power of God, the Son, because of the flesh, thus becoming the Father and the Son. And it's talking about this one person. Okay? And they. Now, what's the antecedent to they? They is the Father and the Son, and they is singular. Now that's not incorrect grammar. They is singular, it's Christ, the Father and the Son. You see that? And they are one God, yea, the very eternal Father of heaven and of earth. And thus the flesh becometh subject to the Spirit, or the Son to the Father. Note he equates flesh with the Son, and the Spirit with the Father. All within Christ. All within him. You see that? Thus the flesh becoming subject to the Spirit or the Son to the Father, being one God, suffereth temptation and yieldeth not to the temptation, but suffereth himself to be mocked, scourged, and cast out by his people. And after all this, after working many mighty miracles among the children of men, he shall be led, yea, even as Isaiah said, as a sheep before the shears is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. Yea, even so he shall be led, crucified and slain, the flesh becoming subject even unto death, the will of the Son, the will of the flesh, in other words, becoming swallowed up in the will of the Father, the will of the Spirit within Christ. You see that? And thus God then breaketh the bands of death, having gained the victory over death, giving the Son power to make intercession for the children of men. Now that will bear a lot of study. And I'd suggest to you that you work on it for a while, because it's the classic statement in all Scripture concerning Christ and who He really was. And it's repeated, the theme is repeated in various ways throughout all of the Scriptures, Old Testament, New Testament, Book of Mormon, Pearl of Great Price, Doctrine and Covenants. This is Christ. If you don't understand this, you don't understand Christ. And it's just that simple. Okay? Alright, so Abinadi's great statement. Now, the key to this whole thing is the conception of Christ. The key to the atonement is the conception. John chapter 5, verse 26. Let me go there just for a minute and get the Savior's statement specifically. He's arguing about to the Jews, and he always gets hassled by the Jews when he's in Jerusalem. He never has a pleasant experience there. He doesn't know what a pleasant experience in Jerusalem is all about. That's one thing he missed the boat on. He just never had a pleasant experience in Jerusalem because of the hypocrisy and the Phariseeism and the blindness of those arrogant people. And he said in condemnation to them, "Ye search the Scriptures, because in them you think is eternal life. But you dummies, don't you know that they are they that testify of me? And eternal life is not in the Scriptures, it's in me." Now we use that scripture to encourage people to read the Scriptures. But let me suggest that you turn over to the book of John and read that in context. And that's the way it should be read, and that's the way it should be understood. They were great theologians. They studied the law. They knew the technicalities of the great gospel so-called authorities of the law. And they placed their whole emphasis and orientation on that. And so in condemnation of them, because they thought knowing the law was going to get them eternal life, he says, "You dummies, you search the Scriptures because in them you think is eternal life. But don't you know that they are they that testify of me, and eternal life is in me?" It's in having a relationship where He is in you and you are in Him. It's not just in following Him. It's that indwelling relationship. It's getting lit up by the candle of the Lord. It's the living water. It's the bread of life. It's that thing that regenerates, enlightens, transforms your soul, that becomes a living source of revelation and of power in your life, see? And this is Christ in you. This is Christ in you, and that's where eternal life is found. Now, you can be damned by studying the Scriptures. I've learned that the hard way. I had the idea of putting the jigsaw puzzle together so you could know everything that the Lord ever said about pre-earth life, and everything He said about this, and about this, and about this, until you get the whole thing down, and you've got all that mastered, and you know that by the power of human intellect. And then the Lord began to teach me that while that's important, it's a means to an end. The thing that's really important is to have the revelatory power in your life and to be one with Him and to get eternal life through Him. See, that's the thing. Now, at the root of all of that, then, is this being who, when he was conceived on this earth, had a unique conception. Jesus was not different by his majestic sinlessness so much as by the nature of his being. He was the only person born in this fallen state who had the powers of the Spirit planted in him in conception that Adam lost in the fall. And he had them on an independent basis. He was God. He was Emmanuel, God with us. And he was conceived of those powers within him. And so he says, for example, in John chapter 5, verse 26, "For as the Father hath life in himself. Now, to even understand that point, that statement to that point, you've got to know how the Father has life in himself. Go to the story of the first vision and take a look at the senior of those two beings who appeared to the prophet Jordan and ask yourself the question, how does he have life within himself? Is he just a great athlete with physical agility and skill? What's all that radiance about? That radiance is intelligence and it's life, and it's the life that the Father has within himself. And then you say this, now on the basis of like Father, like Son, if that senior person was to have a son, as he did, and he was to implant within the embryo of that son the basic rudiments of what he really is, not just physically in the physical traits, but in the divine nature, so that you have a situation of like Father, like Son, then what kind of a son would you have? You would have a son who had life in him on the same principle and in the same way that the Father has life in himself. You see that? And that's what Jesus says here. For as the Father hath life in himself, so hath he given the Son the life in himself. And then over in chapter 10 of the book of John, you have the follow-up statement, verse 18, where he says, no man taketh it from me. He's talking about his life. But I lay it down of myself. Now note this. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. Now who in this congregation tonight can say that? I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. This commandment have I received of my Father. All right, so in Christ, what do you have? You have a being who, by conception, is born above the fall. The vision, for example, of Nephi is really relevant at this point. He wants to know, the angel wants to know about the condescension of God. Knowest thou the condescension of God? God condescended to send Christ. You see that? This is verse Nephi 11. Well, let's go clear back to verse 12. It came to pass that he said unto me, look. And I looked, as if to look upon him, and I saw him not, for he had gone from before my face. And it came to pass that I looked, and beheld the great city of Jerusalem and other cities. And I beheld the city of Nazareth. And in the city of Nazareth I beheld a virgin. And she was exceedingly fair and white. And it came to pass that the heavens were opened, and an angel came down and stood before me. And he said unto me, Nephi, what beholdest thou? And he said, I said unto him, a virgin most beautiful and fair above all other virgins. And note, she was white. She wasn't the swarthy color of the Jews. That's an infusion through Hittite blood. Jesus was blonde and blue-eyed, and he was a man among men. That's the true Abrahamic color and characteristic. He said unto me, knowest thou the condescension of God? And I said unto him, I know that he loves his children. Nevertheless, I do not know the meaning of all things. And he said unto me, behold the virgin. Now he's talking about God's condescension in respect to the redemption of man. And he said unto me, behold the virgin whom thou seest is the mother of the Son of God after the manner of the flesh. And it came to pass that I beheld that she was carried away in the spirit. And after she had been carried away in the spirit for the space of a time, the angel said unto me, look, and I looked and beheld the virgin again bearing a child in her arms. Now Christ was not conceived on this earth. Rather instead, as Nephi says, Mary was transfigured. And she was taken into the presence of the Father. And there were certain rites and ordinances performed, etc., etc. And there was a union and there was a conception. And as a result of that, then, Christ was conceived in the midst of everlasting burnings. And in the act of conception, in the sacred act of conception, the mortal corruption was purged from the embryo so that Christ was born above the fall. Now, the scriptures teach that, and let me just spend a little time with you on that particular subject. Turn to John chapter 10, verse 36. Now, here Jesus is defending himself to the Jews. He's having one of those jolly good times that he has in Jerusalem. And he's being accused of some kind of blasphemy because he testifies of who he really is and says who he really is. And they don't like it. And it says, Jesus said, "Is it not written in your law? I said, ye are gods." This is the one I think I quoted from the prophet Joseph earlier today. "If he called them gods unto whom the word of God came, and the scriptures cannot be broken." Now note in the next verse, verse 36, he's talking about himself. "Say ye of him," i.e., himself, Jesus Christ, "say ye of him whom the Father," now note, "hath sanctified and sent into the world." Now when Christ was conceived, before he was born, what happened? He was sanctified and sent into the world. You see that? That act of sanctification then, he merited by reason of his worthiness. And so we find scripturally then John the Baptist talking about him over here in John chapter 3, verse 31. He says, "He that cometh from above is above all. He that is of the earth is earthly, and speaketh of the earth. He that cometh from above is above all." Now Christ then came from above, and he wasn't part of this mortal order. He was in it, but he wasn't part of it. Read chapter 8, for example, verse 23, where Jesus speaks of himself. He said unto them, "Ye are from beneath, I am from above. Ye are of this world, I am not of this world." Now you have a being then who is God coming into this world. He's the Father and the Son. He's the Father because he's conceived with the power in him. He's the Son because of the flesh. And they together become the Father and the Son and the one God of this earth. See? Now that's Abinadi's testimony in review. You see that? And Jesus then he comes here then, is sanctified in conception. He's sanctified in conception. Now note, for example, the Apostle Peter's statement. This is 1 Peter 1:19. "Forasmuch as ye know that ye were not redeemed by corruptible things, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot." Now, some people have the idea, and the idea prevails at times, that Christ was half-mortal because he was born of Mary. Now, the scriptures over and over and over again equate mortality and the mortal body with corruption. The mortal body is a corrupt body. What does Peter say? "We're redeemed by the blood of Christ as the Lamb without blemish and without spot." There was nothing in him that was spotted. There was no corruption in him. You see that? The Apostle Paul also states, quote, that Christ offered himself without spot to God. There's nothing in him. Jesus says, for example, in John 14, "The prince of this world cometh," verse 30, and he has nothing in me. There's nothing in my being, in my organization, that Lucifer has any claim to. There's just nothing in me that he has any claim to whatever. Not only did he live a sinless life, he was sanctified before he was in conception, before his birth. And then he went to the local McDonald's and ate some of those hamburgers that only kids can eat because they don't have taste buds. Now, he did that from time to time. And so he had to act then to sanctify the elements, that he raised them to the level of the purity of that basic substance within himself. And so he says in John chapter 6, I sanctify myself that they also might be sanctified. The ember comes into the world. And then he raises all of the elements to that level. So that when he goes, prior to going, he can say, the prince of this world cometh, and he has nothing in me. He simply has nothing in me. There's no claim that he has on me. Now, some people argue that you have to have mortality in order to die. I think there's another view, if I can be free enough to express it. The reason that we die is, yes, we're mortal, but fundamentally, we're not inseparably connected, like in the resurrected state. And then when some kind of impact hits us, disease or something, it disintegrates the physical substance down until eventually the spirit can leave the body. And death can come. And death is induced then on the basis of two principles. One, that you're a dual being. And secondly, that something acts upon you to so reduce the whole organism to the point where the spirit can leave. Now, for us, that thing that acts upon us is the corruption of mortality and the diseases, etc., that are incident to mortality, see? Now, Christ was a dual being. He wasn't inseparably connected. He was conceived with glory in him, and I want to get to that a little later here in a minute. He had glory in him in conception. And that glory is life and his power. He was full of grace and of truth. And in that sense then, he had mastery over death. There was no corruption there. But when he went through Gethsemane and took upon himself the sins of the world and also suffered the bombardment of Lucifer with all the power that he could focus. Now, power derives from organization, and power derives from truth. And there's no such thing as power independent of truth and of organization. It just doesn't exist. But Lucifer can take a truth and turn it two notches to the right or two notches to the left. And it still retains the power of truth, although it would be properly called perverted truth. And if he can do that and distort it and still use it, then he masses that power like he did with Joseph Smith in the first vision or prior to it, see? And this is what happened in Gethsemane, along with suffering the withdrawal of the Spirit for the sins of the world and of this eternity, then Lucifer hit him with everything he could muster in an effort to literally disintegrate him back to native element. And the force and the power of the debt of justice and the force and the power of the bombardment was such that he literally began to disintegrate within. He began to smoke within. He suffered, he sweat blood because he was sweating spirit. Can I put it that way? And blood came from every pore of his body. Now that's the atonement, see? That's the atonement. And that experience then followed by that he went through in the ordeal prior to crucifixion, and that which he went through then on Calvary, where when they took him to the hill, they didn't wrestle him to the cross. He walked freely to it and stretched himself out and laid his arms out and offered himself as a free and willing sacrifice. And the whole thing then combined acted upon the physical system like disease and corruption acts upon us. You see, the whole thing combined to disintegrate, but the power of will was still there, and he couldn't have died unless he willed to die. But when he had finished that whole ordeal, which the scripture tells would have killed any man, except for the action of his will. And that's where the statement in Abinadi that the flesh becomes subject to the Spirit, or the Son to the Father, see? And a part of that wasn't just subjection in the sense of obeying the will of the Father. Part of that was hanging on and saying, I've got a job to do. The Spirit wants to leave. I don't want it to leave. I won't let it leave until I have been through the ordeal that's necessary to pay the debt of justice. And finally, when that was done on the cross, then he bowed his head and said, it is finished. And then, under those circumstances, his spirit could leave his body. It didn't require mortality. It required a breakdown of the organism. You see that? Now, let me put it this way. That no Nephite prophet would ever be caught dead calling Jesus a man. I want you to read the Book of Mormon in that sense. And let me read a few things with you on it. No Nephite prophet ever called Jesus a man. It just isn't there. Instead, the direct opposite is there. Let me read 1 Nephi 19 with you for just a minute. Verse 10, beginning. And the God of our fathers, who were led out of Egypt, out of bondage, and also were preserved in the wilderness by him, yea, the God of Abraham, and the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, yieldeth himself, according to the words of the angel, as a man. Now note the emphasis, as a man, into the hands of wicked men, to be lifted up according to the words of Zenoch, and to be crucified according to the words of Nehem, and to be buried in the sepulchre according to the words of Zenos, 3 days and so forth. See, over here in Mosiah chapter 3, verse 5. Here's one then from good old King Benjamin. Beginning with verse 5, he says this, behold, the time cometh, and is not far distant, that with power the Lord omnipotent, who reigneth, who was and is, from all eternity to all eternity, shall come down among the children of men, and shall dwell in the tabernacle of clay. Now, who's it going to come down? It's this God who is from all eternity to all eternity, this being who is omnipotent. He's going to come down, and he's going to dwell in the tabernacle of clay, and shall go forth among men, working mighty miracles. And then in verse 9, and lo, he cometh into his own, that salvation might come into the children of men, even through faith on his name. And even after all this, they shall consider him a man. Now, did you say that he was? No, it didn't. He shall consider him, they shall consider him a man, and say that he hath a devil, and shall scourge and shall crucify him. Abinadi, for example, because he said unto them that Christ, this is Mosiah chapter 7, verse 27 and 8, because he said unto them that Christ was the God, the Father of all things, and said that he should take upon him the image of man, and it should be the image after which man was created in the beginning, or in other words, he said that man was created after the image of God, and that God should come down among the children of man, and take upon him flesh and blood, and go forth upon the face of the earth. And now behold, he said this, because he said this, they did put him to death. Now turn, for example, finally to Alma chapter 34, verse 10. And here's a classic statement here by Amulek, where he's talking about Christ. And in Alma 34 and 10, he says this, for it is expedient that there should be a great and a last sacrifice, yea, not a sacrifice of man. Now, the flip side of the coin then is what? Christ is not a man, right? Not a sacrifice of man, neither of any manner, neither of beast, neither of any manner of fowl. For it shall not be a human sacrifice. Jesus was not human. God Himself shall come down. Jesus was not human. It shall not be a human sacrifice, but it must be an infinite and eternal sacrifice. Now, there's nothing short of deity that's infinite and eternal. And you have God Himself come down. And He's conceived in such a way that, yes, He has blood. Yes, flesh and blood. But there's no corruption in Him. The prince of this world cometh, and He hath nothing in Me, He said. And I have power to lay down My life. I have power to take it again. See, in the whole eternal scheme of justice, the divine justice of God, if a person is tainted with corruption, there's something of Lucifer in him. If a person is in any way, any fraction of himself, is subject to the fall, he can't make an infinite and eternal sacrifice. You see that? He's somehow still under the power of the adversary. And you can't make a sacrifice if you're in bondage or any degree of bondage. Now, that's what the Scriptures teach concerning Christ, see? And he's the God of this earth, and He comes then to this earth, and He's conceived then with the same powers in Him that the Father has in Him. Now, let me put it this way. We're sometimes used to talking about Christ's two comings, the first and the second, in this manner. We say His first coming, He came as just a teacher, and He was born on earth, and He lived a sinless life, and He offered Himself as a sacrifice, and we don't really follow that through very much in insight and understanding. And there wasn't any particular glory about Him or any power about Him. He had some priesthood and healed a few people, and et cetera, et cetera. But when He comes the second time, then the sun will hide its face in shame. The waters will boil. The mountains will fall down at His presence because of the power of the glory that centers in Him. See? Now, what I'd like to say, and what the Scriptures say, is that He came in glory the first time. He came in glory the first time. Now, let me read it to you from the Scripture. Alma chapter 5. And here again, see, these are reasons why you can get closer to God by reading the Book of Mormon than by any other Scripture, including the New Testament. And that's a big statement to make, because the New Testament gives you the very record of the life of Christ, His ministry. And it's a big statement to make, to say that the Book of Mormon supersedes that sacred record in its capability to bring you closer to God than any other book. Now, one reason for that is it helps you understand Christ. If you'll get into the Book of Mormon and read it for something more than its history, if you'll get down to the nub of things and see what the prophets are really teaching there, and if you'll apply an effort to study and analyze, the same kind of effort that a scientist would make in studying and analyzing all the details of a scientific formula. If you'll do that and read the Book of Mormon that way, and then learn what it says and ask the Lord, hey, help me see what it says. Now, here's one of those things that it says. Alma chapter 5, verse 50. Yea, thus saith the Spirit. This is Alma speaking. And he's not saying, now, brothers and sisters, I'd like to give you my intellectual opinion. He's not doing that one. He's putting this on a revelatory basis. Yea, thus saith the Spirit, repent all ye ends of the earth, for the kingdom of heaven is soon at hand. Now, this was about 80-some-odd years before the coming of Christ. He says, yea, the Son of God cometh in His glory. That's first time. You see that? The Son of God cometh in His glory, in His might, in His majesty, in His power, in His dominion. And then he repeats it, yea, my beloved brethren, I say unto you that the Spirit saith, and this is revelatory, The Spirit says, "Behold the glory of the King of all the earth, and also the King of heaven shall very soon shine forth among the children of men." Now, how did Christ come the first time? Abinadi's statement of Him being the Father and the Son doesn't mean anything unless you know this. He's conceived with the power of God. He has the glory in Him by conception. That glory is life. It's a renovating, sanctifying, purifying power. If it's implanted in that embryo, in the conception of Jesus, what's its effect? On the corruption that's there, what has to be its effect? He's sanctified and sent into the world. He's still got blood, but there's purity there. And there's a renovation from the effects of the fall, and He's from above and not from beneath. You see that? And He's God. He's Jehovah. He's Emmanuel. God is with us. And in Him then dwells the glory of the Father. The Father has life in Himself. Now that, for example, a few years later, you have the same testimony of Alma, verse 50. Oh, that's verse 26. Verse 26. Not many days hence. Thanks, Brother Sank. And not many days hence, the Son of God cometh in His glory. Now, how is He going to come in the first coming? In His glory. And His glory shall be the glory of the only begotten. And the only begotten is that being in pre-earth life who had the powers of glory of the Father centered in Him and is the only one begotten in those realms of power and glory. And so He says then, His glory shall be the glory of the only begotten, full of grace, equity, and truth, full of patience, mercy, and long-suffering, quick to hear the cries of His people and to answer their prayers. Now turn, for example, to Alma chapter 13. Here's another one, verse 24. "For behold, angels are declaring it unto many at this time," Alma is saying. And this is still about 80 years prior to Christ's birth. "Angels are declaring it unto many at this time in our land. And this is for the purpose of preparing the hearts of the children of men to receive His word at the time of His coming in His glory." Now, how is He going to come? And then turn to the great vision of Nephi in chapter 11 of 1 Nephi, where Nephi in vision sees Him and testifies then of the nature of His ministry. And in that testimony then, has this to say, 1 Nephi 11:28, "And I beheld that He went forth ministering unto the people in power and great glory. And the multitudes were gathered together to hear Him, and I beheld that they cast Him out from among them." He went forth in great power and glory. Let me turn to chapter 19 of 3 Nephi as a corroborating testimony on this. Chapter 19 is the account of Christ's second day's ministry among the Nephites. I call it the Holy of Holies of the Book of Mormon. It's the great baptism of fire, the beginning of the great baptism of fire of the Nephite people, by which they were made a Zion people, by which they were renovated within and brought up to a spiritual level that we have not yet achieved as a church, and for this reason, as a church, are still under condemnation. But in the course of this event, as these people gathered together the second day, and then they kneeled down and prayed, and in verse 9 it says they did pray for that which they most desired, and they desired that the Holy Ghost should be given unto them. And in context of 3 Nephi 19 and 3 Nephi 12, where Jesus speaks of this, this is talking about the baptism of fire. And so Nephi then takes the 12 down, gets them baptized, and the record says that they beheld that they came out of the water, and they were filled with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Behold, they were encircled about as if it were by fire, and it came down from heaven, and the multitude had witnessed it and did bear record, and angels had come down And so forth. And it came to pass that while the angel were ministering to the disciples, behold, Jesus came and stood in the midst. That's where he made his second day's appearance under those circumstances. And then there's a beautiful situation there, an experience there of prayer and of the endowment of these disciples with the glory of God. In verse 25, it says, it came to pass that Jesus blessed them as they did pray unto him, and his countenance did smile upon them, and the light of his countenance did shine upon them. And behold, they were as white as the countenance and also the garments of Jesus. And behold, the whiteness thereof did exceed all the whiteness. Yea, even there could be nothing on earth so white as the whiteness thereof. And then with that experience now, and all that went into that sacred event, then read verse 35 and see what the Lord says. He says, it came to pass that when Jesus had made an end of his praying, he came unto the disciples and said unto them, so great faith have I never seen among all the Jews. Wherefore, I could not show unto them so great miracles because of their unbelief. Now think of that for a moment. He didn't say, you know, I'm a resurrected being now, and I've got glory and power, and therefore I can show you something that I didn't show the Nephites, the Jewish people, and it's because I just didn't have it to give to them. I wanted to, but I couldn't. I just didn't have it, and therefore you're privileged, because now as a resurrected being I can give you an endowment of glory and power that I couldn't give them. That's not what he said. Now what did he say? He says, you've had something that they haven't had. So great faith have I never seen among all the Jews, wherefore I could not show unto them so great miracles, because why? Of their unbelief. And what's the inference? If they had have believed, what could he have shown them? Did he have it to give? And the answer is yes, he had it to give. He had glory in him. He came to earth in glory. He possessed it. Now you say, well, why didn't he shine then? And there's an answer to that. The prophet Joseph Smith taught, for example, that if a person has a physical body, somehow, some way, there's a means, if he has glory, so that he need not manifest that glory visibly. He says, for example, here in the teachings, page 162, a spirit cannot come but in glory. It don't have anything to hide it. An angel being a resurrected being, an angel has flesh and bones. We see not their glory. You see that? Page 325, the prophet comes back to the same story. He says, for example, spirits can only be revealed in flaming fire or glory. Angels have advanced further, their light and glory being tabernacled. When Jesus was conceived, he was conceived with glory in him. And the Father put him under restrictions, not to visibly manifest it, and not to use it for his own benefit. Rather to repress it and to use it to the degree people exercise faith in him. On one occasion, for example, a woman came to him. She had been through the MD syndrome and suffered many things of many physicians and hadn't received any benefit. And so she wormed her way in through the multitude that was thronging him and crowding him about. And with the kind of faith necessary to tap into the Spirit, she touched the hem of his garment. And the power that was in him flowed into her. And Jesus turned around and says, who touched me? And that was the laugh of the day. Who hasn't? They're just mobbing you is all. They're just thronging you. There's such a magnetic thing there. They're just trying to get all over you. Now, who hasn't? And he said again, who touched me? Because I felt virtue flow from me. The powers flowed. And then the woman confessed, and he commended her for her faith and bid her well for what she did. You see that? All right. Now, when Jesus, in the beginning of his ministry, went into the wilderness and he fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, I've never been privileged to do that while I've been in Snowflake here, and I'm so full as a tick, I have a hard time speaking after getting through some of these dinners. And that's fine. I'm not complaining. But he fasted for 40 days and for 40 nights, and you can get pretty hungry. And then Lucifer came to him and taunted him with some of the local scuttlebutt about him. See, if you had a young girl who finally got pregnant, and she said, "No, I don't know, it's not what you think. It's just not what you think, folks. There's something more to it." And then her intended husband comes in and finally meets the situation and gets her married and takes that stigma a little away. Do you think the devil's going to let that thing stand idly without making a lot of hay on that one? Now, he didn't. He made all the hay he could make on Joseph Smith, the poverty of the family, the circumstances physically, in opposition. What do you think he did with Jesus? Jesus grew up under the stigma of being what we call falsely an illegitimate child. That was the stigma under which he grew up. And when he had fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, Lucifer hit him with that one. It was a sharp barb. If you be the Son of God. And that little word, if, can be very penetrating. If you be the Son of God, then take this stone and create one of those beautiful muffins and put some butter and honey on it and satisfy your hunger. Now, could Jesus have done that? Yes, he could have done that. Did he? No, he didn't. See, he had to repress the divinity within him to be like us. And in a reverse situation, we have to get a little of the divinity that was in him in us in order to be like him. And that's an interesting situation, see? He had a mortality. Can I put it that way? In a sense, he shut himself out from the presence of God by the repression of the divinity within him and by the non-use of the divinity within him. He didn't just see a temptation coming along and run up a shield. He met that on the basis then of integrity and devotion. And as he did that, that action became a refining influence in his life. He talks, for example, in Luke 22 about going with me through the temptations and the trials of my life, speaking to his disciples. See? And he acted on that basis. And as he repressed and acted on the basis of integrity, then what happened to the spiritual powers within him? See, there must needs be an opposition in all things, otherwise righteousness cannot be brought to pass. And so as he met that opposition each time, and did it on the basis of integrity, and did it because of the maturity of his character and of his soul, because he did this, then he drew from grace to grace. Until finally, when he went to Gethsemane, he had reached up by faith and acquired enough of the divine nature of the Father and internalized it and made it his own. And that's what happens when a person gets the Spirit and lives by it. Truth, as we've said this today, lay earlier, is independent. It stands on its own. It has a natural affinity with other truth. Light cleaves to light, intelligence to intelligence, virtue loves virtue. And they each stand on their own. But as a person then receives that from the Lord, and as you go through the refining processes and the disciplinary processes that you impose in righteousness on yourself, then that truth that you receive is embedded within your soul. And it becomes yours. And it's independent. And you stand independent in open union with God. Now, Jesus then incorporated that glory and assimilated it and made it his own. And when he went to Gethsemane, then he was prepared as the God of this earth to make an infinite sacrifice. Now, what did that sacrifice require? What's the basic thing that happens when a person willingly and knowingly and openly transgresses the laws of God? Well, it isn't necessarily that it becomes publicly known and people gossip and wag their tongues and that kind of thing. That's not necessarily what happens. Sometimes it goes on for years. But what really happens? And the answer is there is a withdrawal of the Spirit. There's a withdrawal of the Spirit. And that withdrawal of the Spirit then is the natural consequence of disobedience. And that withdrawal then leaves an aching void within. The heavens seem brass over your head. There's a disintegration of soul. You feel an inner weakness. And there's a disintegration of the very fibers of life within you. And if you continue willfully against that, then there's darkness and there's disjointedness. And you become a congeries of opposing forces within. And it works on your soul, and it works on your mentality, it works on your whole being, see. Now, if you're going to pay the debt of that, what have you got to do? And you're going to pay the debt now for not only the people that you love, you're going to pay the debt for this earth from Adam down. And this being the redemptive earth, that power of atonement is going to go back clear to the beginning. And it's going to include all that the Father gave to him in this eternity. All the people on all the worlds that Christ created. And it's got to be then the exact payment of justice. He's got to suffer darkness. He's got to suffer pain. He's got to suffer an equivalent anguish of soul for the whole group combined. Now, I can't fathom that. But I do know this, that as the God of this earth, as he went through that ordeal, then through the glory that he has, he's an infinite being, past, present, and future are and were with him, one eternal now. And by reason of the divinity within him, his soul can reach into the past and it can reach into the future. And it can reach right into the souls of people in past and the present and the future. And it can bear the burden of sin that they have if they'll turn to him. And so as he went into Gethsemane, the first thing that happened was that the Father withdrew himself. The Scripture says that Jesus walked the path alone, doesn't it? Abinadi says, and I would that he should know that God himself shall come down among the children of men. He didn't say that God shall come down. Now, Christ had been with the Father, and there had been a constant flow of the Spirit. And that union then that comes by that tremendous indwelling relationship of the Father in Christ. And there was strength and there was power there. There was a repression of it on his part in order to go through the mortal probation necessary to prepare that physical body and to raise that physical body in purity to the stature where it could do what it was supposed to do and be what it was supposed to be as a physical organism associated with him as a person, see? It was all of that was there. But as that was the case, then he had the Father withdraw. And so great was the anguish of that divine being that he took off to another part of the universe. But he knew what he had working for him there. He knew what he had working for him. He knew what was in the Son. He knew that the integrity was there. And God himself then, the God of this earth now, independent of the Father, having internalized the powers and the glory of the Father, stood then in that moment of majestic majesty and said, okay, let her rip. And what happened? Well, go to the Matthew account and go to the other accounts of Scripture. Here in Matthew 26, and he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, Peter and James and John, and began to be sorrowful and very heavy. Now here's a divine being speaking. Then saith he unto them, My soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even unto death. Now what is he talking about? Tarry ye here and watch with me. And he went a little further and fell on his face. Just literally out on his face. Buckled at the knees under the power of the ordeal which he then experienced, you see. Over here, for example, in the book of Luke, you have another sacred testimony concerning Christ. As Luke recounts then the events of the crucifixion or of the Gethsemane scene. And he says this. Let's begin with verse 41. And he was withdrawn from them after about a stone's cast, and kneeled down and prayed, saying, Father, if thou be willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. And there appeared an angel from heaven, strengthening him. And being in an agony, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was, as it were, great drops of blood falling down to the ground. There's a disintegration going in, and every fiber of his being is bearing that burden, and blood comes from every pore of his body. In Mosiah chapter 3, you have King Benjamin making a beautiful similar statement concerning Christ. He says this, for example, verse 7, And lo, he shall suffer temptation and pain of body, hunger, thirst, and fatigue, even more than man can suffer except it be unto death. For behold, blood cometh from every pore, so great shall be the anguish of so great shall be his anguish for the wickedness of and the abominations of his people. And he shall be called Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the Father of heaven and earth, the Creator of all things, the beginning and from the beginning. And his mother shall be called Mary. Now there's two features to this whole thing. And here again, the Book of Mormon just gives us a beautiful insight that's important. In the last verse of 2 Nephi chapter 10, Jacob makes this observation. And you need to underscore this one and ponder on it, because it's crucial to the whole picture. He says, Wherefore, and it's kind of a summary on his part, Wherefore may God raise you from death by the power of the resurrection. And also from everlasting death by the power of the atonement. Now Jesus, in this whole process of Gethsemane through into Calvary and the resurrection, acquired two powers. One was the power of the resurrection, and the other was the power of the atonement. Now, which power did he acquire where? Well, he acquired the power of the atonement in Gethsemane. And he acquired the power of the resurrection on the cross and at the tomb when he broke the bands of death. You see that? He acquired that power on the cross. He exerted it in the tomb. Now, what is the power of the atonement? How does it differ from the power of the resurrection? What's the difference? We partake, for example, of the sacrament. We partake of the bread, and we partake of the wine or the water. The bread is symbolic of what? The broken flesh, the Calvary scene. We partake of the wine or the water, and what's it symbolic of? The blood. And the question is, what blood? And the answer, in the sense of primary emphasis, covers both, but in the answer, in the sense of primary emphasis, is the blood of Gethsemane. It was the blood of Gethsemane that he shed and by which he acquired the power of the atonement. Now, in the scriptures, they make that dichotomy and that distinction. For example, in section 19 of the Doctrine and Covenants, you have the Lord speaking rather positively to Martin Harris because of his waywardness, and telling him he really needs to command to repent. He says, "I command you to repent, lest I smite you with the rod of my mouth." Now, that's pretty hard language for the meek and lowly Jesus. "And by my wrath and by my anger, you're suffering me sore. How sore you not, how exquisite you not, how hard to bear you not." And then he explains, "For behold, I, God," and it's not "I, elder brother," it's "I, God, have suffered these things for all, that they might not suffer if they repent. But if they would not repent, they must suffer even as I, which suffering caused myself, even God, the greatest of all, to tremble because of pain, and to bleed at every pore, and to suffer both body and spirit, and would that I might not drink of the bitter cup and shrink." Now, is he talking about Gethsemane or Calvary there? When did he want the cup to be taken? When did he sweat blood at every pore? He's talking about the Gethsemane experience. And he's relating it to the forgiveness of sins and to the blessings of the gospel. This is the power of the atonement he's talking about. Then he says, "Nevertheless, glory be to the Father, and I partook and finished my preparations unto the children of men." And there's significance to that expression, "finished." He says, "Wherefore I command you again to repent, lest I humble you with my almighty power, and that you confess your sins, lest you suffer these punishments of which I have spoken, of which in the smallest, yea, even in the least degree, you have tasted at the time I withdrew my spirit." Now, he's referring to an episode in Martin's life where, in an infinitesimal way, he experienced the same kind of agony that Jesus experienced in Gethsemane. Now, what was that experience? Well, that was the loss of the 116 pages, see? As Mother Smith puts it, as she talks about that ordeal, and I'll cut the thing short on this because we need to move on, but she says, "I have often said within myself, if a continual punishment as severe as that which we experienced, and that others tasted of it, including the Smith family, as severe as we had experienced on that occasion, were to be inflicted upon the most wicked characters who ever stood upon the footstool of the Almighty, if even their punishment were no greater than that, I should feel to pity their condition." See, that's the thing Jesus is referring to when he talks about the smallest and the least degree to which Martin had experienced the Gethsemane-type suffering. You see that? And then he tells us how. He says, "Smallest, even the least degree, but you tasted at the time I withdrew my spirit." Now, what happened to Martin when he broke his covenant with the prophet, when he lost the book of Lehi, the manuscript book of Lehi? What happened to him? The Lord withdrew his spirit. And Martin, in anguish, put his hands to his temple. "Oh, my God, I have lost my soul. I have lost my soul." And cried out in bitter depths of despair for what he had done. And Jesus refers back to that and says, "Now, if you don't repent, then this what you experience is only an infinitesimal part of what you're really going to get. And it's only a drop in the bucket in comparison with what I experienced." Now, the requirement of sin is the withdrawal of the Spirit. Jesus was conceived with glory in him. He was conceived with the Spirit within him. Joseph Smith said that read it to you directly here as he expressed it. He says, "None ever were perfect." I'll quote it before I get to it. "But Jesus." And why was he perfect? Because he had the fullness of the Spirit and greater power than any man. I can't find it, but that's what it says. Okay. Why was he had the fullness of the Spirit? See, he's conceived with glory and power in him. And then he repressed that spirit. And he refined and disciplined the physical organism until when he went to Gethsemane, he had sufficient to pay for the debt of justice. And there's the withdrawal of the spirit, and at the same time, the bombardment of the adversary. And he suffered and bled from every pore of his body and pled, "Hey, isn't there another way?" Now, this wasn't some simpleton saying, I'd just like to have a different color of lollipop, you know, mommy. I mean, that's not that kind of thing. I mean, this is deep seriousness. And he's saying, "Father, isn't there another way?" And he buckles at the knees and he sorrows even unto death. And he bleeds at every pore of his body. Now, that's the blood of the atonement. In a technical sense, Jesus did not die on the cross for our sins. He died in Gethsemane. Now, what did he do on the cross? He paid the debt of Adam's transgression. Now, prior to that, he went through Gethsemane. The Gethsemane did more than one thing. Number one, it paid the debt of justice for erring mankind, for repentant sin. Let's underscore the word repentant. It paid the debt for repentant sin, for all of Christ's creations. That's the first thing it did. Secondly, section 88 says he descended below all things, in that he comprehended all things, that he might be in and through all things, the light of truth. I'll get you the exact verse on that. That is verse 6. All right, he descended below all things, in that he comprehended all things. He went down to the very depths of the sewer, right to the bottom. And he comprehended the depths as well as the heights, and he did it that he might be in and through all things, that he might intelligently know the depths and have the capacity then, on the basis of knowledge and first-hand experience, to then handle the thing and to infuse his mercy into those who are in the depths, and not only forgive them that they will turn to him, but also to infuse his spirit within so that he can be in and through all things. Now, to me, that's what it means to have faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. It means something like this, that you can never find a person who is so in the depths of spiritual darkness and despair and inner contradiction that Jesus hasn't been below him and doesn't know and knows the way out of the woods. You see that? And if that person, wherever he is in that scale of spiritual darkness, will put his trust in Christ, he knows the trail out, and he can get forgiveness, and he can also get the blessings of the Spirit. Now, hinging on, based upon, derived from the atonement experience is, number one, the forgiveness of sin for all those who repent and come into Christ. Number two is an understanding in the practical sense of the depths and the heights, so that you can infuse your glory into all things and be in and through all things. Now, that means then that the power of the atonement does more than forgiveness. It's the basis on which you give the gift of the Holy Ghost to the people. It's the basis on which the gospel program rests. It's the basis of the holy order. It's the basis of eternal marriage. It's the basis of the fullness of glory. It's the basis of exaltation. All of those things center in Gethsemane and are part and parcel of the benefits derived from Gethsemane. That is the power of the atonement. And in that ordeal, Jesus then offered himself with an infinite sacrifice. The divine nature was given as a free sacrifice. That divine nature, the glory, the power that was centered in the conception that he had matured and he had lived a sinless life so as not to lose it like Adam did. See, the sinless life is a means to an end. It's not the end in respect to how he made the atonement or what it took to make the atonement. It's the means to the end. He lived sinlessly so that he wouldn't lose the infinitism within himself, the glory, the power, the divine nature, so that he could offer himself then as, yes, a sinless sacrifice. But it wasn't sinlessness that made an infinite atonement. Sinlessness is not infinite. It's pure. It's holy. You could offer a child as innocent at the moment of birth. That wouldn't atone for anything, and yet it's innocent, right? Now, it took an infinite atonement. It took God himself. It took the sacrifice of deity, of the attributes of deity, of the powers of deity. That's what it took. And that's what Gethsemane was all about. And as Jesus made that offering in Gethsemane, he prepared his physical body for the cross. And that's a very, very important thing. It's the kind of thing that's based on this principle, that if a person is required, or by circumstances beyond his control and power, goes through difficult circumstances, and his faith is in the Lord, he has a right to the sustaining power of the Spirit. When I was in the mission field, my dad wrote me a letter about the time of my birth. We called it Poverty's Point. Our family lived on mud hens and jackrabbits at that time. And in the midst of that, my father had an accident and was laid up. And that was the circumstance and the ordeal at the time I was born. And he wrote to me about that at the time of my birthday, and he made this comment. He says, "You know, son, I would go through that whole experience all over again if I could have the endowment of the Holy Spirit that I had at the time you were born." Now, that's the benefit of adversity. We don't like it. We say when we've had it that it's good to have had it, and we're happy that we're over it. But there must needs be opposition. Now, Christ received the physical body. His Spirit, being Jehovah, had the fullness of the Father within it. It came up to that fullness relatively easy. It was born above the fall, and it had the fullness of the Father in it, see? And the great challenge now is to take the physical body, conceived in the midst of everlasting burning, sanctified though it was, but then to refine and to purify it and to expand it so that the physical can be brought up to the same level in purity that the Spirit, so that the physical can be infused with the Spirit, and so that the physical can be everything that it needs to be a pure and sanctified offering. And so Gethsemane prepared Christ for Calvary. You see that? Gethsemane prepared Christ for Calvary. Now, the offering that he offered might have had blood all over it. I don't know that they gave him a time for a shower. And blood came from every pore of his body. And then he was subject to the cat of nine tails and a few other things like that. And I don't know that it was the cleanest kind of thing in outward appearance. But the physical embryo of that being, when it hung on the cross, had been through Gethsemane. And it had been refined, and it had been purified. And he offered it now as an offering that's necessary now to pay the debt of Adam's transgression. Now let me just review that with you a minute. What did Adam's transgression do? It produced two kinds of death. It produced spiritual death, and it produced physical death. Spiritual death is the withdrawal of the Spirit, so that Adam then got out of God's presence, like we discussed this afternoon. He was out of God's presence. He was severed from the glory. He didn't have the priesthood powers or the powers of the divine nature. He couldn't, like Moses, look at the earth and see every particle of it like he could before. He lost all of that. He died, literally lost life and died a spiritual death. And then there followed that, the physical death. Now, in order for Christ to gain the power of the resurrection, then he had to pay the debt of Adam's transgression. And that required two kinds of offerings, spiritual and physical. And so on the cross, as he hung there in agony, bleeding, with the wounds in his feet and in his hands, not yet in his side, that came after. But as he hung there in the agony of those moments, then the Spirit withdrew again, and he gets back over the Gethsemane experience, and it all comes back to him again. And he cried out, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" You see that? He cried out. He suffered then the spiritual death required to pay the debt of Adam's transgression. And then having done that, then he bowed his head, and his physical body, having gone through that ordeal, was so prepared for death that the only thing that was required for him is to will it. As King Benjamin said, he suffered sufficient to where even no human being could ever endure the things. And he's a divine being. He's a dual being. There's no corruption in him. This is a sacrifice without spot or blemish. This is pure. This is holy. This is not a human sacrifice. It's an infinite and eternal sacrifice. He then says, "Father, into thy hands I commit my spirit." And he passed from this earth. Now, in the resurrection then, as he came forth from the resurrection, he acquired power to do two things. He acquired power to do two things. Number one, to reunite the spirit with the body of every person in the whole of this eternity, sons of perdition and all. And the power of the resurrection acts upon everyone without exception, regardless of wickedness or righteousness. It brings the spirit back into God's presence. And what does it do? And the second thing, it restores the whole, the spirit united with the body, back into God's presence to a state equivalent to that from which Adam fell. And this then is an action of justice and of truth and of equity. We didn't institute the first spiritual death, nor did we institute the physical death. And so we are not responsible. We're not responsible either for the first spiritual death or for the physical death. And so without merit on the part of any person, all people have their spirit united with their body, and everyone, including sons of perdition, are brought back into God's presence to be judged for their actions in the flesh. Now that's the doctrine of the Book of Mormon. We read, for example, and let me just review it briefly and give you a few other scriptures to go with it. We read Helaman 14 today, where Samuel the Lamanite talks about the atonement. And he says this, verse 15, "Behold, he must die that salvation may come. And it behooved him to bring to pass," he says, "the resurrection of the dead, that thereby," and note what the scripture says, "that thereby man may be brought into the presence of the Lord." Now what does resurrection do? Does it just put the spirit and the body back together? The answer is no. It puts the spirit and the body back together that thereby they might be brought back into the presence of the Lord. "For behold, this death bringeth to pass the resurrection and redeemeth all mankind." From the first death, that spiritual death, it redeems all of us without equivocation. He says, "For all mankind by the fall of Adam have been cut off from the presence of the Lord and are considered as dead, both as to things temporal and things spiritual. But behold, the resurrection of Christ redeemeth mankind, yea, even all mankind," note the emphasis, "and bringeth them back into the presence of God." Like we said earlier today, if you were to ask a gospel doctrine class, Does everyone get resurrected, including the sons of perdition? You might have one or two people who just don't know that much. But the general response would be what? Yes, everyone. And if I ask that same class, will everyone, regardless of whether they're righteous or wicked, including sons of perdition, be brought back into God's presence regardless of what they have done? Unconditionally, will they all be brought back? And what will be your response? Rank rebellion if you say yes, but the answer is yes. And this is justice. I've heard people say, for example, that Brother Anderson, they will never behold his presence. They will never behold his face. They might be brought back there and be judged, but somehow they will never really see him. So I have to turn over to 2 Nephi 9 and read them what I call Jacob's woe section. Woe unto the deaf that will not hear, for they shall perish. Woe unto the blind that will not see, for they shall perish also. Woe unto the uncircumcised of heart. Woe unto the liar, verse 34. Verse 35, woe unto the murderer who deliberately killeth. Woe unto those that commit whoredoms. And then he says in verse 38, and in fine, woe unto all who die in their sins, for they shall return to God. I was just talking about the righteous. They shall return to God and behold his face and remain in their sins. Now, are they going to see him? You bet. That's what it says, isn't it? All right, so they're brought back into God's presence and then they're judged. And if you're in the category of the son of perdition, what happens? Then you die under the demands of justice a second spiritual death. And you're cast out and there's no atonement for this one. You see that? Now, can you see the power of the resurrection? The power of the resurrection which Christ acquired versus the power of the atonement. I had a beautiful experience once. I was sitting in sacrament meeting, just contemplating the events going on as the sacrament was being blessed. And about the time the deacon came and gave the bread to my wife and I, about the time that happened, there was a spiritual explosion in my mind. It didn't last probably a half a second. But in that half second, the whole of this concept came into focus in relation to the question of why we partake of the bread before we partake of the water. And it was so beautiful I could hardly contain myself. Woo! Wow! Thank Lord, you know. Wow! And they finally got the water passed and moved on to other things, and I got my pencil out and the writing pad that I learned to carry with me, and I wrote down the main ideas of it. Let me tell you about it. If you study the scriptures, you find that when Jesus administered the sacrament to the Nephites, he did with the bread first and then the water. Now, the bread symbolizes what? The body, Calvary. The water symbolizes what? Gethsemane. On which is based the forgiveness of sins, the spiritual renewal, blessings of the gospel, life, eternal life, glory, power, exaltation, eternal increase. All of that is based on Gethsemane. See? Now, why partake of the bread first instead of the water? What's the reason for it? Now, when you receive the gospel, you've been out, many of you, in the mission field. When you receive the gospel, which phase of the atonement do people receive first? And the answer is the Gethsemane one, isn't it? They get the forgiveness of sins. They get the gift of the Holy Ghost. They can go to the temple and be married for eternity. They can get on the way with all the benefits of the Gethsemane experience. And they get that first. And then they look forward in their lives to the day of judgment, when they will be reunited with their spirits and their bodies and brought back into God's presence. And that's the orientation that you have when you receive the gospel. Now, what is the orientation that you have when you have received the gospel and are under the covenants of the gospel and are looking forward now to its ultimate fruits and its ultimate benefits? The first thing you look forward to is the benefits of Calvary. You look forward to the Spirit being united with your body, brought back into the presence of God, and stand there before the bar of Christ as the divine judge. And hoping that he will say, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant." See, that's the first thing you look forward to. And then the second thing you look forward to is the full consummation of Gethsemane. The Lord to say, "Well done." And he takes your sins, puts them in a little knapsack, ties a rope around them, and drops them into Bottomless Canyon. And that's the end of them. And you have the demands of justice now fully consummated by his gracious act of ultimate and final forgiveness. And then you look forward to the full renewing life that you have as a resurrected being, the fullness of glory, the eternal family, the family relationships, the powers of exaltation and of eternal increase. And all of this then comes from Gethsemane. You see that? And so after you have made covenant with Christ, after you have made covenant with him, then your hope is first of all to be worthy, to be raised by the power of the resurrection, followed now by the full powers of the atonement in all of their ultimate blessings. And so you partake of the bread first, and then of the water. And that whole thing just like a wow, a flash of light. And it wasn't just light in the sense of radiance, light in the sense of insight into all of the details of this picture, just in boom, like that. And I just couldn't help but say, "Lord, thank you." It's right here at the moment of partaking of the sacrament of the Lord's Supper, see? And I couldn't wait till it was over till I started writing the thing down. Now, Christ then paid those debts, and when he came forth in the resurrection, then he had the power. He had mastered eternity. He had a grasp of the eternal order of things which he had created. He had a hold of those things and was master of the show and of the program. And he could give then forgiveness of sins to all who would repent fully and completely. He could give the gift and power of the Holy Spirit. He could give the blessings of the Holy Order in respect to the temple blessings, the marriage relationship. He could give the fullness of glory and of power. He could give the powers of eternal increase. And he could bring you back into God's presence now, put your spirit in your body and bring you back and open the door for all of those things and stand as a righteous judge as to who got what and how much of all of that. Now, this is what he did in the atonement. This is why the atonement is the center of this eternity, of all of Christ's creations. And it's the center then and the basis of everything that you will experience from here to the rest of eternity without end. It will go back and be the basis of that experience. See, it's the greatest act that's ever been performed in the last 2,555,000,000 years with which we have been associated, see? And it's the greatest act of that will have a future infinite, without bounds and limits, infinite capacity and power throughout all eternity. Now, this is the thing that the prophets then of the antediluvian period looked forward to. This is the thing that Abraham desired to see and saw it and rejoiced. This is why Enoch rejoiced that the righteous had been lifted up. And this is why then we should rejoice, and why we should center our lives in Christ. To the degree that you fail to do that, to that degree you will fail in your life. And to the degree that you do that and put your life in Him, surrender your will, and live in Him spiritually, so that with an eye single to His glory, your heart, your soul is centered in Him. And to the degree then that He can be in you by that surrender and by that mature faith and by that openness of soul and of spirit, to the degree then that He can be in you to that extent, to that degree you will succeed. And these are the basic issues of life. I bear you my testimony that Christ did come, that He is the Christ. He is the Anointed One, in other words. And He was anointed in conception. And He made an infinite atonement. And the scriptures that the prophet Joseph Smith gives us an insight into that great event that no other body of men since Christ's day have ever been able to conceive. Luther and Calvin and Zwingli and Melanchthon, Knox and the whole batch of them, all combined, never even touched it in the sense of a candle in comparison with the light Joseph Smith gave. He was a prophet. He is a prophet. Jesus is the Christ. And this is where our lives need to center, in His sacred and holy name. Amen. I've got one or two here, I think, that someone wrote, and maybe we can spend a little time with it. I haven't had a chance to read this. I want to know what element it was that changed Adam at the time of the fall, when he, as a spiritual, physical being, ate the fruit of the tree that was also a spiritual, physical fruit as he was, and was of the same order. Why did it change him? Well, the basic answer is I don't know, and you can quote me. But in connection with that, the trees of the garden were different in nature and character than the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. This was a different breed. This was a different critter, if I can put it that way. This was a different plant. And when we talk about the trees of the garden, they were physical, spiritual, like we said this afternoon. But we don't really know. We don't really know what it was in the forbidden fruit. We know that Adam was not even to touch it, lest he should die. We know that it had properties within it that infused or induced and brought into the lives of Adam and Eve physical deterioration and corruption. Now, along with that, the decree of God, executing the demands of divine justice, severed them spiritually. And that had nothing to do with the effect of the fruit. That had to do then with the demands of divine justice for transgressing the law. And it severed them spiritually, and they died spiritually. And then with that, then, the whatever it was in the forbidden fruit then induced the basic elements of corruption that become the mortal character and the mortal nature. And what that was, we just haven't been told. And so, like I said, I don't know, and you can quote me. Why did Jesus need to have a mortal mother to get into this world? The answer to that is, He had to have a mortal mother to get into this world. But He had to come into this world by right of His status and dignity as God. And He had to come here conceived with life in Him. And He was born of an eternal Father and had planted in Him the divine nature. And the action of the divine nature, even in the embryo, was powerful enough so that the mortal elements were sanctified. I mean, that's only rational as you look at the picture, see. You can't have corruption and that much glory contained in the same being. It just can't be. And that corruption then was purged out in conception. And as Jesus said it himself, and he was the one that said it, the Father sanctified me before birth, sanctified me and sent me into the world. You see that? He was the one that said that. And we need to pay attention to his statement on that. Any other question? Anyone from before here? Hey, I endured faithfully to the end today. How many hours has it been? It's been a glorious time. I feel good. I feel like shouting hallelujah. I've had a marvelous day. My feet, they hurt me. I'm standing here walking. But this has been a marvelous day. I've felt the Spirit of the Lord in a beautiful way. I've asked the Lord for it. I felt it. And I thank you for your faith and for your presence. Pray the Lord to bless us all in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.